So welcome, everybody. My name is Emily Newman, and I am the AHA Education Coordinator. Tonight, we've got a great presentation for you with author Katherine Stewart. I'm just going to give you a quick housekeeping item. So we're both on Zoom as well as Facebook right now. So you can use the Q&A box in Zoom if you're there with us, and I'll read those questions at the end of Katherine's talk. Or if you're on Facebook, we'll be checking the comments. So feel free to put in your questions over there and any other comments you'd like to share with us and the rest of our Facebook audience. And great. And this is part of a monthly speaker series that we have. Usually it's held at the AHA office in DC, and due to situations, we are doing it online now. So for those of you on Zoom, we're going to keep you muted, and you can put in your questions to the Q&A box. And then if you have a technical question I can help you with, you can put it in through chat. So just check to make sure I've got no one. So again, welcome everybody. Tonight we're excited to have Katherine Stewart, who is the author of The Power Worshippers: Inside the Dangerous Rise of Religious Nationalism. Her work has appeared in the New York Times, the Washington Post, the American Prospect, and the New Republic. In a recent review from the Washington Post, it says that The Power Worshippers is required reading for anyone who wants to map the continuing erosion of our already fragile wall between church and state. So thank you for joining us, Katherine. And I will stop my video. All right.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Emily, and to everyone at AHA for putting this together. As I understand it, this is the AHA's first Zoom speaker series event, and I am honored to be your guinea pig. My book, The Power Worshippers, is a deep dive into the machinery of a movement that has turned religion into a tool for political power. So in this talk, I'm going to explain what religious nationalism is, why it matters, and take you on a brief tour, very brief tour of what I've learned. So when we think of the religious right, we're often thinking of a social movement that works from the bottom up. It expresses the anxieties and reactions of a particular group in American society to rapidly changing social realities. But Christian nationalism works from the top down. It actively shapes and manipulates its target population, and it often shifts its target. When we think about the religious right, we're also usually thinking about a cultural movement. It's about symbols, symbolic gestures, or maybe it's about certain very specific aspects of modern life, like abortion, that have somehow acquired extraordinary cultural significance. But Christian nationalism is a political movement and not a cultural movement. It is about power. Christian nationalism, as I'm going to explain in my talk, didn't arise out of the abortion issue. It created abortion as a political issue in its quest for political power. When we think of the religious right, we usually imagine it as one more special interest group in the noisy form of modern American democracy, thinking like a group that just kind of wants to have a seat at the table. We may agree or disagree with its positions, but we see it as a competing within the existing system for votes. But Christian nationalism does not believe in liberal democracy. Its aim is to overthrow, you know, just smash the table altogether and create a new type of order, one in which Christian nationalist leaders, along with their political allies, members of certain approved religions, will enjoy positions of extraordinary privilege in politics, law, and society. Christian nationalists talk a good game about patriotism. They always represent themselves as the true Americans. You'll often see them at their events in red, white, and blue, holding up portraits of George Washington and so forth. But Christian nationalism is not remotely unique to America. In fact, one of the most important aspects of the movement in America today is its affinity for and its alliance with religious nationalists around the world. When leaders like Vladimir Putin in Russia, or Viktor Orban in Hungary, or Erdogan in Turkey, bind themselves closely to religious conservatives in their countries to consolidate an authoritarian form of power. We understand that as a form of religious nationalism. And that's what we're seeing today with Trump's alliance with our own hyper-conservative religious leaders. My book, The Power Worshippers, pulls back the curtain on the leading personalities of this movement and the sort of machinery of it. So in this talk, I wanna give you an idea of how they've turned religion into a tool for political power by focusing on four areas: messaging through churches, a focus on the ideology of the movement leaders, the role of money, and the international alliance. So let's start with messaging through churches. Leaders of the movement have figured out that pastors drive votes. And so they organize conservative-leaning pastors into networks that get them all on the same page politically and give them tools to help them turn out the votes for the hyper-conservative candidates that the movement favors. From their perspective, vast numbers of America's conservative churches have been converted into the loyal cells of a shadow political party. So I want to give you an idea of what this looks like on the ground. Recently, I found myself at a small church in rural North Carolina with dozens of evangelical pastors from the area. It was in a sort of swing district prior to the 2018 midterm elections. And the event was aimed at teaching these pastors how to communicate to their congregations the key issues that supposedly matter at the ballot box and the biblically correct way to vote on them. The event was organized by Watchmen on the Wall. It's one of the a project of one of the leading policy groups of the religious right. It's called the Family Research Council. And Watchmen on the Wall claims to have over 25,000 pastor members. And it's been openly endorsed by hyper-conservative political leaders, including Vice President Mike Pence. So this was clearly not a politically neutral affair, even though it was taking place inside a church. Family Research Council President Tony Perkins, who spoke at the event, said, "I believe this last election, 2016, was the result of prayer." He said, "We've seen our nation begin to move back to a nation that respects the sanctity of life." So what he's signaling here is that the single issue that matters most, the one issue that pastors should care about above all others, is abortion. He knows very well that if you can get people to vote on a single issue, you can get their vote. So quoting from the Bible, he told the pastors, "Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand the wiles of the devil." It was clear from his speech that the so-called wiles of the devil were definitely to be found on the Democratic side of the aisle. So he's casting this as a real fight against good and evil, absolute good and absolute evil. He said to the pastors, "The members of your congregation need to vote. As pastors, I'm not gonna say challenge them. You need to tell them to vote." There wasn't the slightest idea of that they should be voting for liberal candidates or progressive candidates or moderates. It was clear from his speech that Perkins expected pastors to tell their candidates to vote for those hyper-conservative candidates for political office. And then the pastors were instructed to form what they call culture impact teams. The idea is that pastors are going to create within their churches teams of congregants that will, as they describe it, advance kingdom values in the public arena. Pastors are instructed to figure out which members of their congregation are politically active, well connected with other members, and motivated to get them to vote according to biblical values, and then give them these really comprehensive tools to do that. I want to hold up one of them. It's called a Culture Impact Team Manual. So it's not just a couple of pages. It's like, we're talking like 200 pages of material. It's this very sort of sophisticated resource manual that has all these sort of messaging materials and resources to help them do it. And it sort of tells them, you know, what resources when they're from a biblical perspective. And it directs them, of course, to a sort of a climate denial initiative for that. So a fundamental motivation behind the Culture Impact Team is to get around legal prohibitions on the direct endorsement of candidates by churches. Current IRS guidelines require that pastors refrain from campaigning for candidates through their office, and that is from the pulpit, but nothing stops congregants from undertaking their own activism, church-based activism, as long as it's all about the so-called culture. So several years ago, a pastor I interviewed about this type of initiative, he called it a God-given loophole. He said, this initiative threads the separation of church and state loophole. That's what he said. So let me tell you something about the political messaging of the movement. When they're talking to congregants or talking to pastors about the issues that they should discuss with congregants, it's all life all the time. Abortion is the beginning and the end. In fact, they tell the pastors, if someone asks you about the minimum wage, you ask them, what's more important, talking about a few extra dollars or life? So every single issue can be boiled down to those sort of few issues. But when you look at the political messages in more detail, and especially the ones that they're sending to one another, that the leaders send to one another and to the elites in power, it's not all about abortion. A lot of it is about money. It's about how the Bible favors low taxes or no taxes, how the Bible favors minimal government or no government, and about how the Bible is against regulation and against the social safety net, unless the social safety net is managed by the church. But we're going to get into that later, and hopefully we can also talk about how that implicates the movement in some of the inept response to the current political, the current health, public health crisis that we're facing today. So first, I want to tell you what I learned when I visited a large agricultural fair in California's San Joaquin Valley. I was there to attend the 20th anniversary celebration of Ralph Drollinger. He's the founder of Capital Ministries, who targets political leaders at the top levels of government. Who's in the news in the last couple of days because he delivered a Bible study, you could actually access it online, in which he sort of, in some ways, laid some of the blame for the current global pandemic on the gays, of course. So who is Ralph Drollinger? He has a weekly Bible study in the Capitol. It's been attended by at least 11 members of Trump's cabinet, including Vice President Mike Pence, and he says he's communicated with Trump on a regular basis. He also has Bible study groups targeting the Senate and House of Representatives and various state houses. And he's also conducting a sort of form of shadow diplomacy with political leaders around the world. So Drollinger is arguably the most, or one of the most politically influential pastors in America. So why did a man of such influence hold his 20th anniversary celebration at an agricultural fair in the San Joaquin Valley? Well, that's because not only did Drollinger start out his ministry in California, where he's from, but a lot of his early funding was from some of these very wealthy agribusiness leaders. You know, these big agricultural conglomerates create sort of its own kind of plutocratic class. And some of those folks, not all obviously, but some of them were his early funders. And indeed, Trump's agricultural secretary, Sonny Perdue, was on hand at this event to deliver a full-throated endorsement. Now, the expansiveness of Drollinger's positions on domestic, economic, and foreign policy hits home the fact that Christian nationalism is a political movement and not merely a stance in the so-called culture war. Drollinger weighs in on a number of social and economic policy questions, including the idea that social welfare programs, he indicates, have no basis in scripture. In Bible study guides, which he teaches to political leaders, and you can actually access them online, he says, the responsibility to meet the needs of the poor lie first with a husband in a marriage, secondly with a family if the husband is absent, and thirdly with a church. Again, nowhere does God command the institutions of government or commerce to fully support those with genuine needs. So he's sort of aligning himself with the sort of libertarian, like a hyper-conservative economic wing of the Republican Party. And it's a kind of ideology, it's a theology of minimal taxation or low taxation for the rich. It's really kind of astonishing. So another of Drollinger's Bible study guides makes clear that God believes in deregulation of business. He writes, leaders must incentivize individuals and industries, which includes unencumbering them from the unnecessary burdens of government regulations. And he also bashes environmental regulations too. He's got words of wisdom for the workforce. He cites from the New Testament, a first letter of Peter 2:18, servants, be submissive to your masters with all respect, not only to those who are good and gentle, but also to those who are unreasonable. So here Drollinger explains, the economy of Rome at the time of Peter's writing was one of master and slave, the principle today of submitting to one's boss. Submitting to one's boss carries over to today. So, you know, this is all music to the ears of the agribusiness leaders who have funded and support Drollinger, many of whom rely on minimal workers' rights, economic and environmental deregulation to maintain and increase their profits. And this ideology, as I explained in the book, is descended from a kind of pro-slavery theology. It's been this this kind of theology of minimal rights for the workforce and sort of top-down control. There's a kind of through line between the ideology of sort of pro-slavery theologians through to some of the mid-century theologians and then to some of the Christian nationalist leaders. Today, we see it parroted by other members of the movement, including David Barton. He's a historical revisionist, who I call the Where's Waldo of the Christian nationalist movement, because he sits on the boards of so many of its initiatives and he's at the center of so many initiatives of this movement. Barton too has argued that the Bible and God oppose progressive income taxes, capital gains taxes, and minimum wage laws. And this is how he justifies it. He says, since sinful man tends to live in bondage, different forms of slavery have replaced the more obvious system of past centuries. He wrote this in an essay titled, The Bible, Slavery, and America's Founders. He wrote, the state has assumed the role of master for many. State has assumed the role of master for many, providing aid and assistance, and with it more and more control to those unable to provide for themselves. The only solution to slavery, the only solution to slavery is the liberty of the gospel, not the 14th Amendment, not abolishing slavery. I mean, he's sort of deracializing slavery and casting the government, you know, the big bad government, as you know, it's just kind of astonishing. So he wrote that. I just report it. Money. The next topic I want to address is money. The Christian nationalist leaders try to secure and even expand public sources of funding. The movement has learned to siphon public money through subsidies, tax deductions, grants, vouchers, and other schemes. This flow of funds has in turn shaped the ambitions and tactics of the movement. The role of public money is huge. The calls for religious freedom that characterize much of its the movement's activism today, well, you know, they, you know, obviously bound up, first of all, in a sincerely held belief that conservative religious people should be able to discriminate against LGBT Americans, the non-religious women, members of religious minority groups, and others. But, you know, it's not just about a license to discriminate. These calls are really as loud and passionate as they are because movement leaders are afraid that their discriminatory inclinations might cost them all of their lucrative tax deductions and subsidies and benefits that other non-religious nonprofits do not have. But even more than holding on to the gravy they've already got, activists have their eyes on a potential vast flow of public money in the future. That nowhere has this agenda been made more explicit than in the field of public education. Religiously driven activists are determined to expand access to school vouchers, which take taxpayer money and flow it, send the flow over to private, often religious schools. So they've placed a key voucher case before the Supreme Court, which many of you know about, I'm sure. So the potential flow of public money is really quite large. I mean, America K through 12, I think we spend about $600 billion a year on public K-12 education in this country. So movement leaders realize if they can get their hands on a fraction of that money in the name of religious liberty, the money will flow without end. So again, they're securing ways to fund their religious groups with taxpayer funds in a host of other areas. In fact, 8 federal agencies recently announced changes in the way to, that they're gonna fund religious groups that will allow those groups to refuse to comply with the anti-discrimination law, even if they're taking public money, and in some instances, allow them to proselytize or require church service attendance for people receiving those services. So that's their agenda when it comes to money is really very ambitious and bold, and often I think underappreciated. So now let's look at the international agenda. This is sort of the last section of what I want to examine in this talk. The Russia collusion thing wasn't really just a one-off where Trump made an alliance with a single foreign entity that just so happened to want to help him. Under Trump, the United States has become a flashing beacon of hope for a new tactical alliance. It calls itself the Global Conservative Movement and claims that it seeks to defend what they see as the natural family. But it's really all about taking down modern democracy and replacing it with authoritarian faith-based ethnostates. You could call it a kind of a global holy war. The movement within the United States is in reality just one piece of this increasingly interconnected global spanning movement. The international global conservative movement has nuances specific to different countries, but each defines itself as a single common worldwide enemy, and that is global liberalism and the values of the Enlightenment. So I went to one of their conferences. They hold conferences every year, every few years. It's called the World Congress of Families. It was held in 2019 in Verona, Italy. I just thought, it's Verona. How could I not go? So I heard an American radio host who's sort of popular with a far-right crowd describe the common foe as, quote, the anti-cultural processes of globalization and its secular aristocracy. Another speaker, founder of, so really they're casting everyone who sort of opposes this agenda as secular. And by the way, I think it's important to note that a lot of progressive religious people are thrown into that bucket. Another speaker, founder of an activist group that promotes culture war campaigns in dozens of countries, named a familiar hit list: radical feminists, the abortion industry, and what they called LGBT totalitarians. This is what they call it. He warned the crowd of the urgent need to, quote, break the ice cap of political correctness. And he said, please try to make liberal politicians and decision makers fear you. Another speaker, a Russian activist who has involved himself in a host of far-right American groups, said the scientific worldview, the Darwin theory, it's the same organizations, the same people who promote LGBT gender rights. It goes in one package. He added, this is fun, gays and Darwin, somehow they're connected. I'm sorry, I have to laugh here. The global holy war has an unmistakably theocratic vision for the future. We are not medievalist throwbacks, we are the future, said one of the American speakers. And he said, there's nothing, absolutely nothing the secular world can do about that. The World Congress of Families got its start over 20 years ago when American and Russian activists gathered in Russia. Looking around at my fellow conference goers, it occurred to me that if the Russian government wanted to manipulate the politics of the West as effectively as it controls its own population, it could hardly have found a more useful collection of people. So now that I have given you some bad news, I want to give you some good news. The rise of religious nationalism should be cause for alarm for all of us who care about the future of democracy in America and who care about pluralism, equality, and our constitutional principles. Yet it should not be the cause of despair. Overcoming this kind of reactionary and authoritarian movement isn't just something Americans can do. It is what has made Americans who we are. Many Americans today are mobilizing to confront the threat, including so many of you on this Zoom cast. When right-wing ideologues have sought to disenfranchise voters, to pervert the meaning of freedom and of conscience and freedom of speech, to target the rights of specific communities, and to defend criminal actions by their enablers, Americans have organized to meet the challenge. In some ways, Christian nationalism is a fruit of society that has not yet lived up to the promise of the American idea. There is work to be done, but for now, at least, we're free to do it. We've met challenges in the past, well enough at least to make it to the present moment. Religious nationalists are using the tools of democratic political culture to end democracy. I continue to believe that those same resources can be used to restore it. Thanks so much. I hope you guys have some questions. And Emily, I look forward to hearing them from you.
Thank you very much. Yes, we definitely have some questions. And Facebook is a little bit behind, so we'll probably have more coming. So one is the question of, did political strategists design the church congregational activism manuals, or did it come from churches?
The culture impact team manual, this manual right here, is a publication of the Family Research Council. So it's appears to have been designed by them, because it is distributed by them, and it's got their logo right here on the cover. Let me explain. The Family Research Council is one of the leading policy groups of the religious right. They have multiple initiatives. Watchmen on the Wall, which is their pastor network, is one of them, but they are active in other areas as well.
And there was one question, I don't know where it, where in this it happened in your talk, but someone wanted to a reminder of what Ralph's last name is.
Ralph's last name is Drollinger, and the name of his group is called Capital Ministries, C-A-P-I-T-O-L Ministries. He puts most of his Bible study writings, you know, online, his Bible studies online. He's also published this really lovely book. Wait, do I have it? Yes, I do have this book here. It's called Rebuilding America, The Biblical Blueprint. So, you know, it's really talking about, he's just got so many wonderful quotes in here. You just can't get enough of them. He talks a lot about how, you know, we too will be governing authorities of sorts under his perfect rule and authority. He says, if you're a believer reading this, get ready to king in our future life. He talks about, Christian believers will soon, someday, I hope, become the consummate, perfect governing authorities. Praise God. So he's basically talking about the need to target political leaders with his theology and how appropriate that is. Oh, here's a good quote. Why is reaching kings and those who are in authority so important? It goes without saying that political leaders are the most influential people in the society. So winning leaders for Christ and planting churches in these focal points, he's talking about state capitals and the capital of our country, Washington, D.C. So winning leaders for Christ and planting churches in these focal points, is something that he endorses. So he's got a whole interesting theology. He's got some pretty scary positions. He is an unrepentant advocate of people actually spanking their children to discipline them. He's got a whole Bible study about that. It's really disturbing. He also thinks that he disapproves of women having any kind of authority over men in church and at home. He says, you know, this is what God wants. It might not be what I want, but this is what God wants. So he's sort of endorsing these idea of hierarchies rooted in the Bible, you know, God ordained. It's some disturbing stuff.
So another question is, how sustainable do you think the entanglement of religion and the right wing can last? It seems to be going too far past the average religious person's point of view. Could a Biden or other candidate, because we, you know, can't get into that, win significantly turn the direction of religious influences?
I think in a country where 40 to 50% of people don't vote, you don't need a majority to dominate. All you need is a small committed minority to dominate. I was at, you know, for the research that I do, I go to a lot of right-wing conferences and strategy meetings. And I remember Ralph Reed, he's the head of another, one of the major right-wing policy groups. He said, it doesn't matter our share of the population. Don't pay attention to that. That doesn't matter. Our share of the population is getting smaller. All that matters is who turns out on election day. So they really understand, like, they can get their people out to vote in disproportionate numbers, and that's how they win elections. And, you know, it really points to the fact that, you know, in a system that's politically fragmented like ours, even small groups, if they're united, can win. It points to the fact that there's so much need for unity among those who reject the politics of conquest and division that this movement represents, people who support equal rights for all and who don't wish to see our country turn into a theocracy. There's so much sometimes squabbling among different, you know, candidates for, you know, do I want to have a beer with that person? Do I like this person's detail on this particular policy? One of the ways that religious nationalists dominate is they have trained their people to vote not just on, like, you know, abortion, but judges. Specifically, they talk about judges all the time, the necessity of getting the right judges in place. And I think if we can sort of set aside some of our squabbles or differences and unite when necessary, we can absolutely beat this.
Speaking of the idea of beating this, we do have several people asking about what can humanists and atheist groups do to push back, especially in terms of like the local small ones, not just the big national side.
Well, I think anybody who wants to push back is welcome to use the tools of democracy to restore democracy. The right has invested in data, media, and messaging. They've invested in the like the kind of internal architecture of modern political campaigns. They work on, you know, they're not just voting themselves, they're holding others in their circles accountable for voting. And I'm seeing, frankly, a lot of, I mean, this is a really weird environment right now. So it's really hard to know how that's going to play out. But I have been seeing, an awful lot more activism, still see a lot more activism today than I saw 4 or 5 years ago, where I think a lot of people really didn't understand why their vote mattered. And I think today a lot of people really understand that. You know, if everyone would just do one step above what they did last time, we could all do pretty well.
There's also a question on that's how so many of these policies would go against the interests of the people who support them, like blue collar workers, minimum wage workers. How do those at the top win them over to these folks at the bottom?
Well, again, through issues like abortion, same sex marriage, and all those kinds of issues are really played for political gain. I was at a mega church in Chula Vista, California. It was a pastor's event for largely Latino pastors. The leaders who held it, it was held, you know, largely in the Spanish language with some Anglo speakers and translators and some Latino speakers. And they were talking about the need to, you know, fight for life. Again, that's where that one pastor, the speaker said, you know, when your congregants bring up the issue of, like, you know, wages and minimum wage, you got to say, you know, what's more important, talking about the minimum wage or life? So if you put it that way, people think, oh gosh, I guess, you know, abortion, life itself is more important than, you know, the minimum wage. But they also did this kind of thing that I found slightly devious. They handed out a piece of paper that was supposedly representative of sex education curricula going into the public schools. And the way it was like a mashup of graphics and text, and it contained all of this kind of frankly lurid stuff. Look, I've got two kids and they're in public schools, and I was looking at this and it suggested, you know, these lessons are being taught along with this graphic at the kindergarten level. And I'm looking and thinking, well, that seems a little weird. I wouldn't want my kindergartner to learn these lessons. It's not quite age appropriate. And what is with that graphic? It's horrible. So I called up, and then they on the other side of the sheet of paper was a list of, like, you know, 70 something lawmakers, and they were all Democrats except for maybe one, and said, all of these lawmakers support this kind of stuff going into your public schools. And the speakers are like, look, pastors, it's coming. You can't opt out. It's mandatory, which is a lie, because you can opt out of those lessons. People, parents are allowed to opt out of sex education. But, you know, I called up the San Francisco Unified School District. I thought, let me just check this out, see if these materials are really being taught in public schools. It turned out the materials, it was a highly misleading. So some of the materials that are, it looked like they were being taught at the kindergarten level or the, you know, K to three, were taught at the high school level. So in fact, they are age appropriate. They're not being taught like to little kids. They're being taught to kids who are older. And a lot of the materials were not taught in any of the public schools at all. So this is one of the ways that people who are, you know, are manipulated to kind of, you know, to vote for these sort of hyper-conservative candidates.
Another question says, I didn't hear you mention the role of the Catholic hierarchy in all this. Is the hierarchy part of this movement, or is there still some underlying anti-Catholicism among the evangelical leaders?
You know, the movement is often described as an evangelical movement. It's not quite right. It includes many evangelicals, but it also excludes many evangelicals too. And it includes representatives of a variety of both Protestant and non-Protestant religion, including hyper-conservative Catholics. We can look at somebody like Bill Barr, who is one of Trump's closest allies. And what he's a sort of hyper-conservative Catholic, but in a way, his Catholicism is not the point. The point is really that the form of religion to which he subscribes is sort of hyper-conservative variety. So Attorney General Barr, it shows, number one, that he is, the movement isn't exclusively evangelical, obviously. Number two, if you look at Barr's speeches and stuff that he's written, he is out there blaming every ill on society on secular people. It's like, he thinks secular people are out there ransacking everything that is holy and good and responsible for every ill in our society, from, you know, drug addiction to breakdown or this or that. So it's like, it actually shows something else that's really important about the movement. Its hostility to secularism is very, very pronounced.
This reminds me of the wedge document / strategy, but much worse in aims. Are the organizations and audiences more or less the same?
Can you be a little more specific about which wedge strat, with the wedge strategy you're discussing?
I think we may need to come back to that.
Okay, great.
The person can respond. Let's see, another one would be, someone asked if you had thought, I don't know how to pronounce this name, but thoughts on Ivan Illich? I think it's Illych. They recently finished The Road to Unfreedom by Tim Snyder. And they're curious if you have thoughts on that and if you cover any of it in your book.
I don't have any thoughts about that particular book. I haven't read it yet.
Okay. Gonna try to do a couple more before we run out of time. Someone was asking about if you would be able to name or point out any of the religious right people in the White House who are influencing Trump.
No, it's really interesting. I mean, there are so many. Obviously, Paula White, who is now a member of Trump's is now on staff. She said it is God who raises up a king. She's actually kind of compared Trump to sort of a biblical figure who's been raised up by God. She's a very interesting character, sort of in the prosperity gospel vein of the movement. There are so many others. If you look at Ralph Dollinger again, if you look at cabinet sponsors, I looked at it today, there were 12 members of the Trump administration as capital sponsors of capital ministries, including Bridenstine, Pompeo, Pence was up there, Sonny Perdue, Betsy DeVos. I mean, really, Trump is kind of surrounded by folks that have a sort of, you know, that are kind of on board with this kind of religious nationalism. But it's important to note that the movement is not united by any sort of theological distinctions. It's really more united by a common political vision.
Great. So one important one that stood out to me, someone asked, how do you maintain your sanity or not suffer ulcers due to rage? They don't think that they could handle all of the research that you've handled.
Well, I think it's just fascinating. I mean, I love what I do. I just think it's really interesting stuff to look. Political movements are really complex, and I think this one is more complex than most. So kind of learning about how this kind of power builds is really interesting for me. You know, my friends, my family, obviously keep me sane. And you know, what really gives me hope is folks like the people listening to this Zoomcast who really care about our democracy and really want to make a difference. And that's really what gives me hope and keeps me going.
Another person asked, which European countries have the most powerful Christian nationalist movements?
Well, there are different ones growing in different countries. So Poland, I think, has a kind of very strong sort of alliance with the conservatism, sort of religious conservatism in government. Russia, obviously. I mean, if you look at leaders like Erdogan in Turkey, again, or Viktor Orban in Hungary, or Putin, allying themselves with these hyper-religious folk in order to solidify their authoritarian power. Those three could be included. There are different movements in different countries, like in Spain, there's a fellow there who started a kind of messaging initiative that is operating in dozens of, in multiple countries. It's very strong. So, you know, the movement shows up in different countries in ways you wouldn't always expect. In chapter 12 of my book, I spent a lot of time in the UK and interviewed some folks who are part of the Church of England, Episcopalians, and they talked about how there's a kind of rising, much more sort of theologically strict evangelicalism in some of the the theological institutes there and seminaries, and that's changing the nature of the sort of the religion. And the Church of England, as many people know, has had a kind of split between moderates and more conservative types. So it's definitely not just an American issue. I think religious nationalists are always, Christian nationalists in America are always talking about American exceptionalism, but there is nothing particularly exceptional about Christian nationalism in America. It's shared all over the world.
So on that note about the American side, someone was asking about is this movement soft on racism and the Charlottesville style nationalism that we saw? Is it like encouraging more of that kind of protest?
That's a really great question. The racial dynamics are complex. I think for a lot of the white people in the movement, the rank and file, Christian nationalism is an implicitly white movement rather than an explicitly white movement. It sort of ties the idea of America to specific racial and cultural identities. So it's a form of identity politics in a way. And they also, I think leaders of the movement often paper over the ways in which hyper-conservative religion and racism reinforce one another. And then if you look at someone like Trump, he's obviously succeeded in part by appealing to the racism of some of his supporters. But leaders of the movement can see the demographic future as clearly you or I. And I think they realize they're not really going to survive unless they capture some subsection of votes among people of color, specifically in certain districts. So in recent years, they've really made an effort to engage and empower pastors of color at the very least so that they can capture some section of their votes, you know, to get some number of their votes, comments to vote for their candidates. But, you know, there's this iron here, is that these pastors of color are being enlisted to fight the culture wars that drive support for a political party that's, you know, made voter suppression and race-based gerrymandering a strategic imperative. And that sort of they're the ones who sort of are actually separating children at the border from their families as a policy. So it's complicated.
So before we started this, you and I were talking a little bit about also the religious impact on the response to COVID and the kind of ignoring the scientific side and pushing for more prayer. Do you want to share any other thoughts on the effect of religious nationalism on these big events?
Sure. I mean, I think that, you know, first and foremost, the movement promotes hostility to science, and anti-science culture rejects the evidence of science. It rejects expertise. It rejects critical thinking. That has, I think, obviously contributed to our inability to address the crisis in an evidence-based fashion. Misinformation is rife in hyper-conservative religious communities that were all in for Trump. Not only that, but Trump has elevated people, you know, around him, not because of their expertise in managing in the issues that they're meant to manage, but because of their adherence to an extreme ideology, and more to the point, because their political loyalty. So you don't have the smartest people in the room that we really need to be having right now. And I think there's another point, and it's becoming increasingly obvious, is that we have a poorly developed collective infrastructure. This is a consequence of decades of right-wing economic policy. And the movement is implicated in that too. It's allied itself completely with a kind of libertarian, pro-corporate economic conservative wing of the Republican Party that has privatized the healthcare system, hollowed out the social safety net. They're constantly demonizing government and working to tear down things like, you know, the ability to sort of manage things in a collective way. So even so far as to, you know, members of the religious right even have called government-funded food stamps and housing assistance unbiblical. I'm thinking about, you know, Ken Blackwell was with the Family Research Council. So that's an enormous reason why we're not prepared for this crisis. It's times like these that really need a public, like a coordinated public health response. And we don't really have that in place right now in the way that we should.
So unfortunately, we can't get to all of the questions, but I do want to wrap up with Katherine sharing both how to connect and connect with you or find more of your work so people can follow up, as well as if you have some like action items that you want to recommend that we take either as an individual or as part of, you know, the bigger humanist movement.
Well, thanks so much. You can follow me on Twitter at Kath S. Stewart. There are two S's there. A lot of my work is archived at katherinestewart.me. And please buy my book. It's called Power Worshippers: Inside the Dangerous Rise of Religious Nationalism. And I think that there's a lot of encouraging movement on the part of those who really care about our democracy and want to restore it. And, just encourage everybody to continue to pay attention to what's happening. I don't think we can meet the challenges we face unless people know about them. So I want to thank you so much for attending this this talk.
Great. Thank you so much for joining us, even with this, you know, special circumstance of needing to be online. But we are happy to have Katherine back later this fall in person, and we have several books already at the AHA office that we're happy to sell and have her sign when we have that event. Thank you to everybody who attended, and hope you look for more speaker series events in the future, and also make sure to stay active with us and Katherine working to secure the separation of church and state instead of let people erode it. We're gonna close it out. Thank you. Have a good night. Stay safe, everybody.
Bye.